You know, we've been talking in this series about crossover times, and before I go there, you know, we are definitely in a crossover time in our world. In case you haven't seen the Newsday, Jerusalem, we talked about this flotilla. I guess it's starting to make headway, and the Israeli naval commandos seized control of a French ship attempting to break Israel's sea blockade of the Gaza Strip yesterday and towed it into port, reporting that there was no resistance during the takeover on international waters. The takeover was the latest in a series of run-ins on the high seas between the Israeli Navy and the pro-Palestinian pro-Palestinians trying to breach the blockade. The military has warned it would stop any attempt to break the sea blockade of Gaza, which Israel imposed 4 years ago, and what it says is a measure to prevent arms smuggling to Gaza's ruling Hamas militant group. And, you know, you're going to hear a lot more in the next coming months, especially as September comes around, because of what's going to be happening in the UN. The Palestinian government is going to be pushing for an all-out vote to make itself a state. There's a lot of things going on. I'm not going to get into all of it right now. We'll talk about some of this during the month of August. There are events happening in Israel. And even though they're good events for Israel, a lot of what these good events are also can be used as a way, unfortunately, to, if you want to call it, stimulate the radical Islam hatred towards Israel. So even though that there are a lot of good things that are going on as far as promoting and defending Israel, it's probably going to even anger the extremists that much more. And I wouldn't be shocked, let me just say this up front, and I'm not being prophetic here, I wouldn't be shocked if you see something of a crisis happen in the next couple of months in that part of the world. I mean, it wouldn't be something that you'd wake up and you'd say, wow, how could that happen? There's a very strong possibility something's going to happen. To say what it is, only the Lord knows. But barring that, we have our own crisis even here in our country right now. Our president now has basically wanted to turn back what God has called an honorable estate between a man and a woman, change the laws of marriage on a federal level. We are in a crisis, without question about it, in our country. This is more than a financial crisis. This is more than a terrorist or a border crisis. We have a character crisis right now. And our nation, if we do not, I believe, somehow find some kind of turn in the character, Psalm 11:3 says, if the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? And I believe the church has to really set a playing field on this in prayer like it's never done before, because only prayer can turn hearts around. Only God can provide miracles. And we are definitely at a crossover moment. Let me make no mistake about it. I believe the next year or two, what happens in this country, without question, is going to determine where this country is going to find itself in future generations. So we really need to pray, and we need to stand. How many believe that as believers, we need to stand for what's right and let it fall where it may? It doesn't mean we're not going to meet resistance and even hatred, but, you know, there comes a time like Peter, we ought to obey God and put aside what man has to say. And but tonight, I thought in line with these crossover times that we're talking about, one of the crossover times, I don't know if I'll get done tonight, this subject, because it's such a... well, let me put it this way. I could probably talk on this subject for the next couple of months, and I would still have more to talk about. But we've talked about crossover moments in the area of obedience. We've talked about it in the area of failure. But tonight, I'm going to ask you to turn in your Bibles to Acts chapter 20. And we're going to look at three verses. And I think everybody's going to relate tonight to what I'm going to share. And it's going to affect every one of us, because if we're not going through at one time or another, we're going to all face this crossover time or moment in our life. Paul was warned, you know, by prophetesses of that time that he would be facing going to prison and possibly even death if he continued in his journey. As a missionary. But when you get to verse 22, there's something about Paul that's going to speak to all of us tonight, especially as Christians of faith. And now he says, "Behold, I go bound in the Spirit unto Jerusalem, not knowing the things that shall befall me there, except that the Holy Spirit witnesses in every city, saying that bonds and afflictions abide me." There was no question about it that Paul was headed for a time of tremendous persecution and affliction in his life. And he says, "But none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course." Now watch this word, "with joy." It's one thing to go through trials and afflictions. It's another experience to have the joy of the Lord going through those. That's a supernatural impartation that comes from within. The Lord one time spoke and he said, "Out of your innermost being will flow rivers of living water." Happiness is an outward occurrence, but joy is an inward occurrence. And it doesn't matter where you are, who you're with, or what you're going through, you can have the joy of the Lord no matter what. And that's what Paul basically says here. He says, "Neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God." And basically, he's giving his farewell speech in that next verse, which you don't have up there, but he's basically saying, "You're not going to see my face any longer." And what he does is he has a crossover moment in his life. He's warned by his fellow brothers and sisters, "Paul, you know, don't go this way. It's only going to be trouble." But Paul realizes that he can't be led by the opinions of people, that he must be directed and led by the Holy Spirit. And so even though it's the most discomforting place he has to go to, better to be in discomfort and be led by the Spirit than go by way of the flesh and be in comfort. And this is a powerful thing. A lot of Christians, especially American and westernized Christians, have a very difficult time with. I was listening to one of the reporters today, and you know, they've said, you know, "We've experienced in our country the last few years crisis without pain. And you know, we're trying to constantly make it comfortable for people." But there are times in life that it's not comfortable. When you have to cut a budget because you can't pay out anymore and you're overextended, it's not comfortable. But it's a necessity in life. And there are some people that are not willing to go through those difficult moments of discomfort to experience once again what I call the right thing. To do the right thing. And how many know when you're doing God's thing, you're doing the right thing? When you're going through something in life, if God has led you or brought this into your life and you follow his ways, how many know he says, "I will be with you through the valleys of life. I'll be with you through the difficulties." He said, "When you're in the waters, I will be with you." So I'm going to use this term tonight, and I think we're all familiar with it. It's a crossover time. If you haven't been in one yet, maybe there's something wrong because you're not on the right planet then. It's a crossover time when you get to this place, a trial in your life. Any of you facing a trial right now, any going through any trials, just be honest with, okay. So look at all the hands that are up right now in this room. I would say to every one of you, as long as you're living for God, it's a common thing to go through trials. It's not the abnormal thing. You know, you ever hear these people all the time, "How are things? Great." Life is not always great, especially living in a sin-filled world, living in a planet, again, that has the Prince of Darkness ruling it. And Jesus said, in this world, you're going to have what? Trials. In this world, you're going to have trials. And Job put it perfectly when he says, "Man is born unto trouble as sparks fly upward." And so this idea, and sometimes I think it's promoted with miscommunicating, even from the pulpit sometimes, that once you come to know Christ, your life is going to just be a bed of roses. We forget. We are to bring forth the fragrance that a rose will bring, but we must never forget that there are thorns in the rose bush. And that's what life is all about. We are to bring forth the fragrance of Christ, and that doesn't mean only in the sunny seasons of life, but even in those stormy seasons or dark seasons. I like what one writer said. He put it this way. It is the roughness of the grindstone that sharpens the axe. It's the storm that hardens the fiber of the oak. And it's those trials of life that shape the heart of men and women. And so today, as I was finishing up the message, I just happened to come across this poem, and I thought, you know, I'm not really a poem reader, but this was so powerful for tonight's message, I couldn't help but allow you to hear it. And it's written many, many years ago. The title of it is, He Maketh No Mistake. And I just want you to listen to this. My father's way may twist and turn. My heart may throb and ache. But in my soul, I'm glad I know he maketh no mistake. My cherished plans may go astray. My hopes may fade away. But I still trust my Lord to lead, for he doth know the way. Though night be dark, and it may seem that day will never break, I'll pin my faith, my all in him. He maketh no mistake. There's so much I cannot see, my eyesight far too dim. But come what may, I'll simply trust and leave it all to him. For by and by, the mist will lift, and plain it all he'll make. Through all the way, though dark to me, he maketh no mistake. And I thought to myself, you know, how many things in life we just don't know why. We don't fully comprehend. And ultimately, what I want to tell you is this. Even though we may not understand, how many know God has our steps ordered? Nothing, and I'm going to say this again, nothing comes into our life without God's final approval. So when we talk about what Paul said to finish out our what? Course, our ministry, our life with joy. Through those trials, God is with us. Through those difficulties of life, God never leaves us. And as hard as those things may be, God, even though they may be hidden to us, has a purpose. And we may never even know that purpose until we get to the other side. So tonight, we're going to talk a little about, or at least start a little bit, about this crossover moment or time in our lives called trials. And since so many of you raised your hand tonight, I think this is going to be an encouragement and a strength and a help to all of you, because sometimes it's not easy and we're questioning. And you know, through wrong theology, and I say this, erroneous theology, there are those that say, God, I'm trying to follow your ways. I'm trying to do the right thing. I'm trying to be a person of faith and live the life that you want me to live. Why, God, are you allowing this to come into my life? And that's not an unusual question. You know, you may read this and think, you know, Paul is this superhuman, but maybe you could just flash this up. There's a scripture that comes to my mind. Could you get 2 Corinthians up there? I think it's chapter 7, verse 5, just to show you that Paul is as normal as you and I are, that when trauma hit him and crisis hit him, difficulty hit him, his emotions got the worst of him at first. Watch what it says. For when we were come into Macedonia, our flesh had no rest, but we were troubled on every side, without were fightings, within were fears. And I want to tell you something. When you're going through a trial, it's not abnormal to go through inner turmoil. In other words, you may feel anxiety, frustration, fear, and all these other negative emotions. Unfortunately, that comes from what? Our human frailty, our nature. God knows that. Like I said before, God pities us. He understands. He has compassion on us. But what God wants to give us is to bring us through our fear so that we can put our total trust in him in our trial and know that wherever God takes us, it's going to be a good place. That's what God promises. And that's in Psalm 66. I think I'll get this one right. Psalm 66, I didn't give you this one either. They're just coming to my head as I'm telling you so they can see. Psalm 66, verse 10 through 12. See if you can get that one up there. For thou hast tested us, thou hast tried us as silver is tried. Thou brought us into the net. Thou laidest affliction upon our loins. Thou hast caused men to ride over our heads. We went through fire, and I'll just put this, we went through all hell. But thou brought us into a better place, a wealthy place. So I just want you to know that if you're going through a trial, God has a place at the end of that trial, and that is going to be a glorious place, and it will bring him honor. So don't try to get around the trial. Don't try to go over the trial. Like Daniel, you've got to go through the lion's den. Like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, you got to get into the fiery furnace because that's where God is. And you want to be exactly where God wants you to be. How many know that's the best place to be? Okay, so let's take a look at this tonight. I think you'll enjoy it, like I said. And the first thing that is common, trials are sweet or bitter depending on how we view them. And there was one Roman historian named Seneca, and he said these words, "Our grief lies in our own opinion and apprehension of miseries." In other words, the way that we view sometimes these calamities or crises of life or trials of life, it's basically from a human viewpoint. We don't see it from a vertical viewpoint. That's why Paul writes, "Set your affections on things above," because when we set our affections on the Lord, he gives us a vertical look into our trial. He sees it from a much higher perspective than us. And so there are numerous ways that people view trials. So I just wanted to say this to you. And hopefully, like I said, you'll understand by the end of our teaching that many of us have had these erroneous beliefs. They're not uncommon. Some people believe that trials are a form of punishment that come from the things that we've done in the past. You know, like penance. We're getting paid back for what we did. How many know that is erroneous according to the Bible? How many know everything was taken care of where? At Calvary, at the cross. He took all of our transgressions, all of our sins, all of the past mistakes, and he put them in the sea of forgetfulness, and he says he remembers them no more. He said, it is finished. We don't pay for anything. He paid it all on Calvary. So if you're going through a trial and the devil is whispering in your ear, boy, this is payback for what you did back then. I know that's a religious mindset, but it's not a biblically faith mindset. Second, yes. Well, generational curse is quite different than that. A generational curse is something that comes down in a spiritual, you know, demonic spiritually from one generation. But once we come to Christ, the curse is broken. See, he became a curse on the cross for us. In other words, that curse. And what she's speaking about, in case for some of you that may not understand this, it's true that sometimes from one generation to another generation to another generation, it seems that this sin, besetting sin, follows, or this predisposition to a certain sinful behavior or even maybe a bondage. I'll give you an example. Sometimes we see it in a family line, alcoholism, and it goes from, you know, the grandfather to the son, you know, to the grandson. It follows. It's not just people drinking and getting drunk. It's actually a curse. Sometimes it can be in other areas. But I'm not going to get into that tonight. I'll talk about that some other time. But what happens once we come to Christ? The Bible says that man is brand new. The old things pass away and all things become new. So that curse is broken through the cross. But what I'm saying tonight, that people's mindsets, and a lot of this, again, comes from our old way of thinking or what people have injected into our life, thinking that somehow we're going through what we're going through right now as a payback for what we did in the past. That is biblically incorrect because Jesus paid for our past sins. Okay, and there's no such thing as penance for a Christian. We don't pay for anything. It's all paid for. He says, it is finished. Secondly, some believe that Christians, you know, who basically, you know, go through things, you know, like trials, when they reach a certain level of maturity, that all of a sudden trials dissipate or leave, and then the rest of your life is one blessed, happy life. That is completely false. There is no say. As long as you're living in this world, you're going to have trials right into the end. And number three, there are those, and I hate to use this term, but they are of the positive confession mentality. They live in denial, and they don't even want to talk about suffering and trials and difficulties. They just avoid the whole issue. They say, don't talk negatively. It has nothing to do. It's reality. Sickness is a reality. Divorce is a reality. Hardship is a reality. Losing a job is a reality. All of these things are realities. Metaphysics says don't talk about those things because they're negative. But that's not Christian. That's metaphysics, okay? And that is contrary to Scripture. And yet some of that has come inside of our church today. But anyway, let's take a look tonight at James chapter 1, verse 2, and see if we can get a little insight here. It says, my brethren, count it what? Here's that word again. What? You would think these guys are masochists. Paul's talking about joy, going through persecution and affliction. James says, when you're going through a trial, count it all joy. I don't know if I woke up tomorrow morning and all of a sudden, you know, the roof fell down. I don't know if I counted joy. But you see, here again, what happens, Paul gives us this understanding. Our emotions, the natural part of us, doesn't mean that we don't feel the pain, the hurt, the sorrow, the upsetment, the anxiety, and the frustration, all of these things. But what happens is that's where we have to turn from that condition. And we have to what? Turn to the Lord. We have to put our complete trust in the Lord. The joy does not come from natural means because we've dealt with the problem or we have a solution. No, the joy comes by supernatural grace that God internally brings you to a place where you realize that God is in what is happening in your life. Because God is what? In the good times, but he's also what? In the difficult times. He says, I'll be with you in the mountains, but I'll also be with you in the valleys. He said, I will never leave you, nor what? Forsake you. He said, I will what? Be with you unto the end. So it doesn't matter what part of the roller coaster ride you're on. How many know God remains faithful to you in that? So Paul, James writes these words, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations, knowing this, and I want you to know, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. Watch this, but let patience have her perfect work, that you may be perfect and entire, wanting it. The word perfect here is not perfect in the sense that we ever become perfect. But how many know our goal is to be perfect? What do you mean, Pastor? Our goal is to be like Christ. So what he's saying is this. Problems are what? A normal part of God's plan for our life, but they have purpose. And the purpose is that inwardly, we now begin to what? Have perseverance to endure because we know that we are being tried for what? Ultimately to the place that God wants to bring us. We saw it before in Psalm 66. It says a prosperous place, but it actually means a place of maturity, a place where now we grow in Christ and Christ can be seen through our life, not through the mountain experience, but when we're down in the valley. How many know that's where people are influenced by our lives? It's easy to thank God when you've got money in the bank, you're driving around in a nice car, everybody's good and nice at home, the kids are fine, the dog's behaving himself. It's easy. But all of a sudden, when all of that gets shuffled around, and now you're going through a difficult moment in your life, the testimony comes in allowing the joy of the Lord to come through our lives, even when we're going through the crisis, even when we're going through the trouble, even when we're going through the trial. It's not something we can do in our own terms, and you'll understand this before we get done. But I want to just share four quick things here, and we may just get started tonight, all right? And then we'll get into it a little deeper next week. The first thing I want to tell you is some think it's a theological tightrope I'm going to say. But it's really not. And the first thing I want to tell you, no one is immune to trials. As long as you are human, you will experience trials in your life. The thing that we have to understand is that there is some kind of, again, false theology that tells people that once they come to Christ, that somehow that God, he puts a certain bubble over certain people, and he removes the bubble from other people's lives when it comes to trials. That is not the case. I want to tell you something, and I know, again, people misunderstand what I'm going to say, but I think David wrote it in the book of Psalms. He says, why did the wicked prosper? Did you ever wonder sometimes where someone is living an ungodly life, And yet it seems everything they touch turns to gold. And so the question that many people have is, why, Lord? But we must understand that there are many things that are, again, hidden to what the human mind, that are hidden to even the spiritual mind, because it's only those things that God reveals that we begin to what know and understand. But I want to look at this from a biblical perspective tonight. In Matthew chapter number 5, verse 45, he's talking to us that you may be the children of your Father. But watch this next part. For he maketh his sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and he sendeth rain on the just and on the unjust. And so that means if there's a rainstorm coming and there are two people walking down the street, a believer and an unbeliever, the believer is not going to be able to walk in between the drops. What hits the unbeliever is going to hit the believer. And that's the reality of life, that what happens to unbelievers, the same thing happens to Christians, but there's one big exception or difference. And we'll talk about that in a moment. Okay, stay with me. The next thing I want to share with you is that trials bring tensions that are easily interpreted as unfair contradictions. And let me just show you what I mean. How many people have met people who are like Job's? They were supposed to be his comforters and friends. But how many know they were his accusers? And all of a sudden, Job loses what? His family, his 10 children. He loses his money, all of his possessions, and he even loses his health. And what do his friends try to do? They're basically trying to find out, Job, there's got to be something in your life that hasn't been cleared up with God yet. Again, this is erroneous theology. And so, you know, you try to raise your children in the perfect way as a Christian, and all of a sudden, they're out there doing drugs, partying, and they're like the prodigal children. And you know, people, you know, so-and-so comes over to you and say, there must be something you did wrong in your parenting. You know, these are Job's comforters. They come. I'll say it again. Trials bring tensions that are easily interpreted as unfair contradictions. And so, you know, I was in a household one time where the mother was an atheist and the father was an alcoholic and the daughter turned out to be a missionary. Figure that one out. And what I'm saying is life sometimes gives us lemons. You know, you know what I'm talking about. And of course, some say make lemonade. But it's difficult sometime because you have people around you that begin to question when they see calamity come into your life. And God has an equalizer on that too, you know, because calamity is going to come to them too. And as they say, before you point your finger at somebody else, you better get ready to point one back at yourself, because it happens to everybody. It has nothing to do, listen to me, it has nothing to do with one's sinfulness, because we're all sinners. We're all people who fall short of the glory of God. And Job finally comes to this revelation. Notice what he says in Job 42:3. Who is he that hideth counsel without knowledge? Therefore have I uttered that I understood not things too wonderful for me, which I knew not. In other words, what Job is testifying here to God about is, you know what? I thought I had this whole thing down pat. I questioned you, Lord, and I said, if I could only stand before the courts of God, put my case out before him, I was a good man who escheweth evil, who did the right thing, and all of this calamity has come upon me. God, what's going on? You know what? Job never found out that he was on display in heaven. He never found out that he was a showcase before Satan and the demonic hordes of hell. You see, we don't understand sometimes what's going on. We think things just happen. They don't just happen. God has a purpose in everything he does. And so, like Job didn't find out why he had to lose his 10 children, his health, and his wealth, the simple fact is that some things in life we're never going to find out until we get to the other side. But it's important that we understand, like Paul said, that no matter what happens to us, that God will give us his internal joy if we will have a trust in his purpose and his plan for our life, no matter how difficult the roller coaster ride may be. Okay, the next thing, trials are reminders of our own weakness, forcing us, what? To draw upon God's power. You know, there's some things in life you just can't handle on your own anymore. There are just, you know, a point where human resources run out, where the expertise, the professionals, and even the monetary abilities of others will not cut it when it comes to certain kinds of trials and troubles in life. And so the Bible is very clear in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 29. He says, he giveth power to the faint. To them that have no might, he increases strength. There comes a time in your life when you're going through a trial or trouble, you just have to throw yourself on the mercy of the Lord. You just have to throw yourself on him completely. Cast all of what you're going through upon the Lord. I mean, just put it on him. And I know that's hard because, you know, our mind doesn't stop thinking. We still wake up at night in thoughts. But even when we wake up, we've got to get back to that position and say, God, I'm awake, but I'm going to put it back on you because you told me that you giveth rest to the children of God. And Lord, I want to give this to you tonight so I can go to sleep. And when you look at this, you know, Jacob came to a place in his life where he couldn't work his way out of it. And what did he do? The Bible says he held on to God for dear life. And he said, God, I'm not going to let you go. Right? Did he not say that? Until you bless me. Now, blessing comes in many different ways. And people don't understand this either sometimes. That the blessing of God doesn't mean that we're always going to get out of a situation. It just means that God is going to bring us to a place that he desires. That's what this whole crossover moment is about. And this is why when we read the 23rd Psalm, a lot of times we read Psalms and 23rd Psalm, even though I go through the valley of the shadow of death, what? I will fear no evil, okay? Because the Lord is with me in that situation. Doesn't mean that my emotions aren't going to experience fear, but it's at that moment while I'm going through my fears and frustrations and anxieties, that, Lord, I know you're with me. And there's a point, and I don't know what that point is for every person. There's a point where all of a sudden the grace of God comes upon you and he carries you through the situation that you are going through. You don't realize it, but it's literally the presence and the power of God that uphold you. And some of you know what I'm talking about because you've loved people who've gone on to be with the Lord. They've died. And you knew it was the grace of God that upheld you through that awful human experience that got you through. And even though there was pain, there was emotional, deep pain and sorrow, that today you're sitting here because it was God who was able to take you through that valley, that shadow of death. You know what I'm talking about, that experience of life. And so, last but not least, and this is a powerful thing right here I'm going to share with you. Humanity, that means you and I, plus trials bring humility and maturity. I want you to think about that. Humanity plus trials bring about humility and maturity. And the reason I say that is this. Trials do something to us that nothing else does. Trials have a way of breaking us. And what I mean simply by that, brokenness before God gives wholeness to our lives. What do you mean? You know, Peter thought he was strong. Remember the story? I think I told the story just recently. Remember he said, Lord, I'm not going to let him take you to the cross. Peter thought he was strong. And what did Jesus say? Peter, Satan has desired to sift you like wheat. But I am praying for you that your faith will not fail. And the fact is, how many know Peter's faith did fail? He denies the Lord three times. And he is broken. But that brokenness does something to him. And what it does is it brings him an understanding of the words of Christ that no longer become just words. It becomes all of a sudden an enlightenment to his life. That enlightenment is simply that he cannot live this life of following Christ in his own human strength. You cannot live the Christian life by principle. You cannot live the Christian life by practice. The only way you can live the Christian life is by power. And that power comes to those who are broken. And that is where the power is. Listen to me carefully. Weakness puts power on display. I'll say that again. Weakness puts power on display. Paul said, when I am weak, then I am strong. What did he mean by those words? Do you remember what happened? Paul writes, after receiving many revelations from the Lord, he was going through some kind of pain in his life, so much discomfort that he cried out to the Lord three times, and he said, Lord, take this discomfort, take this pain, take this trial from my life. Three times. God doesn't answer him. He writes, in hindsight, a messenger of Satan was sent to Paul to buffet him. I'm not going to get into it, whether it was a physical malady, an emotional, or a relational. But the fact is, something so tremendous in his life that he understood that it was a messenger of Satan. It was a demonic thing, but God allowed that demonic thing to attack his life. And through that, after crying out three times, he discovers something. He hears the voice of God. My grace is sufficient for thee. And that's where we begin to understand that in the trials of life, forget this theology that tells you everybody has to be healed, everybody has to be set free, everything's going to be made right. Some things aren't made right. Nobody wants to see a job that they've worked their whole career for lost in a moment because of some employer who doesn't like you. No, nobody wants this, but it happens. It happens to the believer. It happens to the unbeliever. Nobody wants to see a house vanquished, but it happens to believer and unbeliever. Death comes to believer and unbeliever. That's part of life. That's why I said nobody escapes this, whether you're righteous or unrighteous, believer or unbeliever. But here is what we must understand. For the believer, there is a purpose in our trial. It's not without cause. And that simply is, it does two things. It keeps us in a place of humility. And when that happens, we become, watch the word now, meek. When I use the word meek, don't think of it as a weak term. Meekness actually is strength that is harnessed under the control of the Holy Spirit. What do you mean, Pastor? You've seen those thoroughbred horses. You've seen those jockeys on them. You've seen how they're able just to turn them just by a little, you know, nudge of the foot or the hand. Well, the same is in our life, that when we come under the Spirit's control, that is what Moses was. The Bible says he went back to the Lord again and again before Pharaoh. God, what should I do? God would tell him what to do. This is a complete dependence on the Lord. And as the Bible says, Moses was the most meek of all men on the earth. What we need to understand is that meekness is not a sign of weakness. It's a sign of strength, that rather than lose ourselves, we're restrained sometimes by the Holy Spirit of doing or saying things that we shouldn't say or do. Get a little amen on that one. How many know that's a strength? Somebody cuts us off, and rather than something come out of our mouth that we shouldn't be saying, the Holy Spirit that moment restrains us. That is what we're talking about when we talk about strength under control. Somebody does the wrong thing to us, and all of a sudden, now it's not just pastor teaching this on Sunday, but what? The Bible says, bless those who curse you. Pray for those who despitefully use you. Do good to them. You know, those are just words until what? Until all of a sudden we go through an experience where we are broken. We find ourselves in human weakness, and now we realize that it is God's strength. I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. He says, without me, you can do what? Nothing. And so this is the whole thing about trials. Remember what I said about crossover times? They're not just about a place of destiny in our life, but they're a place of shaping who we become. Trials make us different than what we once were before we went through that trial. We're going to come out a different person if we put our what? Trust in the Lord completely. And what will happen is God is going to then, after he brings us through that trial, I believe in hindsight, show us that there was a purpose that he may not show us the exact purpose, but we will see some definitive purpose in our life why we went through that trial. And ultimately, God will reveal all of it when we get to the other side and we're with him in heaven. But I believe with all my heart, when you look at characters in the Bible and you begin to see Peter and Paul and Moses, you know, There were moments in their life where they reflected. I'm sure Moses, after 40 years back on the desert, and then one day delivering the people of Israel through the Red Sea, he understood that God had a purpose in everything that he did. Jacob realized that after God changed his name to Israel. You know, we see this throughout Scripture that people, men and women both, went through these trials in their life, but their lives were shaped. Esther was shaped by the trial she went through. Remember Mordecai? Even sometimes there are people in our life and they come alongside of us as encouragers. Sometimes they even give us words of exhortation. And Mordecai came alongside of Esther and he said, Esther, you may have been called for such a time as this. Fear gripped her heart. She didn't want to go into the king without him holding out the golden scepter. It would have meant death for her. But he challenged her because all of the people of Israel were going to be exterminated, and she was in a position that had the possibility of causing a release of that execution upon their life. But it could have also meant her own life. And she was willing, at what point? Not at first, but through the exhortation of someone else. And that's why the Bible says, provoke one another to love and to good works. We need to encourage one another, especially when we're going through trials, because we all go through trials. And that's why there's this commonality that brings about words not only of just encouragement and strength, but experiences that we are able to what? Not just share with people, but pray through for one another. Because everybody goes through it. You know, we think some families just have it all together, and then one all of a sudden has all hell break loose in the house. And, you know, up to that point, life has, you know, been great in the family life. But then this one thing happens, and it's so destructive. But God knows how to come, sometimes through another person, sometimes through a preacher, sometimes just through his word. But he comes in these moments to us to let us know that he will work all things together for good. This is the promise that you have to hold on to when you're going through a trial. We know that all things work together for good. To them that look, in spite of what other people do, in spite of circumstances, in spite of, well, you could fill in the blank. Forget about it. You know what it looks like in human terms. God, you have to hold on to this promise. I'll never forget my wife in the first Bible she gave me. That was the first scripture she gave me. And I was going through a real trial in my life at that point. And she said, and we know that all things work together for good. To them that love God, to them that are called according to his purpose. And I look back now at that time, and it was a year and a half, maybe even a little bit longer, that I was going through the trial of my life, and for something I did wrong. But the possibility was a long prison stay for me, and rightfully deserved if it occurred. But at one point, I can't tell you where that point was, I came to a place of releasing it to the Lord. And I said, God, if you want to allow me to go to prison for what I did, I'll use that time in a worthwhile manner to be at least a witness for you in that prison. I came to that place of resolve. And God, through his mercy, chose another path, another crossover moment, as they say. We don't know what they are, but how many know God knows what they are? And it's all how we respond biblically at that crossover moment that determines what we become. We will either have a life of joy or a life of regret, depending if we respond biblically at that crossover moment or respond unbiblically, or as they say, in the flesh. So where are we? Let me just see. Oh, I'm done. All right. That's okay. That's okay. I can't believe how quick. Doesn't time fly? Especially when you listen to the word of the Lord. Amen? So this is just the foundation. Okay? Next week, I'll close with you because you're going to see some powerful things that the Lord showed me about trials. And if you're going through one right now, we're going to just trust the Lord that not only is he going to bring you through this trial, but that when you come out of this trial, you're going to be the better Christian. Something is going to happen to you going through that, as they say, cocoon, that dark place that is going to bring you out on the other side. And it is going to have such an effect upon your life that you're going to say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We don't thank God in the Bible says, give thanks unto the Lord, what? In all things, not for all things, right? What's the difference? We don't thank God for sickness. But the Bible says we thank him, what? In the midst of the sickness. We don't thank God when everything, you know, gets blown out of our life, and you know, everything we work for has been. We don't thank Him for that, but we thank Him through it. And as we begin to thank Him through that, God is able to lift us and hold us. We're not going to, like I said, get around it or over it. We're going to go through it. But when we get to the other side, we're going to see. He says, behold, I will do a new thing. And that's what God does. I call it chapters. I always use this term. We all have chapters in our life. There's a point where God closes one chapter. That's it. He writes the end. And then all of a sudden, you get to the next chapter. And sometimes in the middle of that chapter, meanwhile, and there are other things that go on. But ultimately, like I say, God has a beginning when He took you into this world, and He has a time where He's going to take you home with Him. In between, that's what life, the life we live is all about. It's between the bookends. You know what I mean? Yeah, exactly. And the thing is God's not going to write your book the same as my book. God has a different chapter for all of us. So never compare your chapters with anybody else unless you just want to encourage people when they're going through their trials. Because God has a different, as they say, ride for all of us. The important thing is that you stay with the ride on Jesus. Don't get out. Stay in the boat. Right? Amen. Any questions tonight? We just started this. Yes, Rose? But he never knew that. I mean, right. In reality, you know, he never knew that God was making a showpiece of him before the devil.
Right. But what about, and I have somebody in my mind, in my life that I'm thinking of, that what if someone has unrepented sin in their life from long ago?
Right.
Do you think it's possible that their illness and their sickness throughout life and just having a difficult life, very difficult?
I know what you're saying. Listen, I'm going to say there are principles in the Bible. It's called cause and effect. There are things in life we escape by the grace of God. There are other things that, you know, we do, and because of what we do, we pay the price. Okay, if you shoot heroin in your arm and you keep shooting heroin, one of three things is going to eventually happen. You're going to come down with some sickness. You're going to have been, you know, overdosing, or, you know, you may end up going to prison, getting caught, you know, doing drugs. That's a cause and effect, okay? But what you're saying is that there are people in life that sin. Let's just look at a certain type of a sin. Let's just say somebody's a gambler or whatever they may be doing. And they never repent of that. Now, the point being is that gambler may have some terrible things that happen to him down the road. Would those things have happened had he not been gambling? Only God knows, you know. But Paul says these words to the Christian. God forbid that I should purposely sin because I'm under grace. See, a lot of Christians have misunderstanding. They think because I'm a Christian, you know, God understands and, you know, I'm forgiven and whatever. God searches the heart of every man and woman. And I believe that. And God knows our capacity. And God knows how much pressure He has to put on people to get them to turn. We try to sometimes play the Holy Spirit and say, God, you need to do this in their life. Forget that. God knows exactly. He created that person. He knows the direction. Some sin He reveals, like He did with David's, Bathsheba, and other sin, for whatever reason, He keeps hidden. But a lot of times, I believe the Lord doesn't bring certain sins to light in public view is because there's a repentive heart. God knows that there are some people that will keep going in the direction they're going until that sin is revealed. So I'm not God, and I don't have all the answers to this, but what I'm trying to say is I never want to sit in a position as Job's comforters and say because somebody has happened, this is happening in their life, unless God really shows it to me. See, that's another thing. We have to understand. I'm not going to get into this tonight. We don't have time. God has given the church power, and He allows us to operate in the gifts of the Holy Spirit. It doesn't mean I can work them at will, but there are some things in my life, and I'm not going to get into it tonight, that God revealed to me by the Spirit. Showed me as clear as day, like I was watching a color movie. You know, God can do that. Now, when God does that, it's a, you know, for the person who has that responsibility now of maybe confronting somebody because God has shown them. Okay, that person better take heed to what that person is saying. If they say, the Lord spoke to me or showed me this, and that person knows that's exactly what they did. God's not just revealing that thing so, you know, they can make them feel, you know, bad. He wants them to what? Change their way or change their direction or whatever it may be. So the Christian operates from a completely different perspective. And that's why, like I say, when you watch a lot of these programs on television and you see they're operating only from the natural, therapeutic, and so forth, we have something that the world doesn't comprehend, doesn't understand, and that is the anointing of God. And sometimes there are things that God will do in our life and show us and prepare us for ahead of time. And when that happens in our life, you will know it because you know it's not from natural means. Nobody, you know, all of a sudden called you on the phone or you got a letter in the mail. It happens by way of the Holy Spirit, and he brings it to you. And I've had these experiences, and I want to tell you something. They really humble you because you realize that, you know, God, gee, he just did something supernatural in my life. And when that happens, like I say, you will know it, and nothing will shake you. From once God does that, you know, no opinion of man or whatever. But I would just be hesitant for anybody here to ever try to play the role of the Holy Spirit and make judgment calls, okay? That God said we're not to judge anybody. It doesn't mean that we are not what? To be cautious, to be people of wisdom and counsel. But judgment is in the hands of the Lord. God deals with people. He says, judgment is mine, saith the Lord. So we're not going to try to judge anybody, but we can definitely be what? We can be discerning as far as what? People's actions. We know certain activities and actions are sinful. And how many know there is nothing wrong with telling somebody, hey, you know what? You keep walking in that life of sin. You know, you may pay a high price for that sin. That's not because we hate them. It's because what? We love them and we want to tell them the truth. But how many know there's grace and there's repentance with the Lord? The whole purpose of revealing to someone their condition is not to make them, listen to me, feel like they're any less than anybody else. It's to show them, once again, that in their sinfulness, they're separated from God. And the way back to God is only one word, repentance. Unless a person truly not just says, Lord, forgive me, but is willing to change their ways, there's not going to be, again, that ministry of mercy and grace that God has. You have to, the prodigal had to turn back. And so that's the whole purpose. But I say Christians must be very careful. We are not to judge people. I don't care what lifestyle they're involved in. Right. Well, what I'm saying is, I definitely believe that there is a sowing and reaping. The Bible says this, if you sow to the flesh, you will reap of the flesh. If you sow of the Spirit, you're going to reap. Whatsoever a man soweth, the Bible says, God is not ignorant. Whatsoever a man soweth, so shall ye reap. Now, you know, it says in Ecclesiastes, and I think it's 7:1, cast your bread upon the waters and it shall return to you, you know, and so forth. There is a principle in the Bible. There is a cause and an effect. So all of a sudden, if I continue to sow, let's just say, what word should I use? If I sow into people's lives constantly criticism or negativity or whatever it may be, and I keep sowing that, the Bible says in the tongue there is what? Life and death. Now, the point being is that if I keep sowing that, what's going to happen to my own life? I'm going to start to reap those things that I sow. And if I constantly sow in the realm of whatever it may be, there's a certain reaping that, you know, it's like a boomerang that comes back. To say to what degree, that's judgment. I'm not going to do that. I don't understand that. But I know one thing, and I don't care who the person is. If a person truly repents before God, no matter what they've done, the Bible says that that person can be saved and can be transformed and changed, no matter what they've done in life. And that's the good news. Okay, so I just want to leave everybody with the good news tonight. But we're going to get back because the Lord gave me a lot of deep things that I think are going to help you in the area of trials. And like I said, if you sometimes around Christians and they make it like life is just so great since they're a Christian, it is great to be with the Lord, to know the Lord, but it doesn't mean that life is great. There's a lot of sad things about life that we're going to experience. Jesus said, if you're going to rejoice, where does our joy come from? Your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. He said, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. You know, Paul had hell on this life. Can I tell you, just personally, when you read the story of Paul, his life was, in natural terms, nobody would want to live his life. It was one big life of trials. But you know what? Ultimately, he had to leave this world, and guess what? He said, my departure is at hand. He said, and the Lord has the reward waiting for me and for all those who love his appearing. And so I just want to encourage you. We don't look at the things that are natural. We look at the things that are eternal. We don't look at the things that are seen, but the things that are unseen. For this light affliction that we may go through in this life works a much greater weight of glory that God has waiting for all of us. So we have to get our mind, what? Out of the horizontal, and we have to start looking more at the vertical. Amen? Brethren, if you'll come, I have some good news. August 21st, mark this down on your calendars. Daryl Strawberry and his wife are going to be coming Sunday morning. They're going to be here. I think you're going to really be blessed by both of them. His wife is a dynamic speaker, and we're looking forward. Please pray about it. We'll have some flyers made up. Really ask the Lord not to bring you believers, but to bring unbelievers. We want to really trust the Lord that unbelievers, two have gone through, they'll tell you when they tell you their life story together. They've gone through a lot of different things, but God has been gracious to them. And they're still working through things in their life. But I think it's going to be a powerful time in the Lord. Again, mark that down, August 21st, Sunday morning, and we'll ask God's blessing now.